Welcome back, everybody. Hope you guys are doing good. Hope you guys can hear me okay. I have a generator running in the background, so I'm prepping for some stuff that a couple friends and I are doing. But what I wanted to do is answer a couple questions for you guys. One, I'm losing my voice, so I've been talking to a couple of groups on the phone and just going through, and it all has to do with Israel and the European forum and all that stuff, the economic forum and all that stuff, and because there's a lot of proposals that are coming on the table, what they can do and what they're going to do. So they wanted to know, the information that's coming out, which ones have authority and which ones don't. Anyways, very interesting, very cool stuff. But I wanted to knock this out before I get too busy with you guys. So, and also I was very, very excited on some of the questions. All right. I got a question from a gentleman, and you guys, I'm going to ad lib this a little bit. I don't have it right in front of me. But he asked, he's like, look, what, you know, I don't understand. You from a historical point of view, you're intertwining a rock. Like, can you narrow it down more what the threat is? Like, you know, what is a rock looking at? You keep saying that they need to figure out if they're going to go with the BRIC side or the, the West side, the United States, the European Union, all that stuff. And he says he understands that, but, you know, can you narrow it down on what the threat, or is it multiple threats? And that is an unbelievable question, because usually people, you know, we're simple, you guys. We're, you know, and that's just the way we are, all of us. Even the people that are super, they consider themselves super, super sophisticated and educated, in the end, we're simple, you know. But what we do is we latch on to one thing and that's it. In other words, one definition. All right. So I'm going to read, and this is out of my book coming out next year. So I'm going to read a few chapters for you, or not chapters, but a few lines for you guys, and set this up properly. So what I'm going to show you is, you know, what's the business. You know, people always talk about the New World Order and monarchies and all that stuff. So actually, what happened? Forget about all the prejudice and, the cheering for one side or the other. But what actually financially took shape? What reshaped the planet? And this will answer your question. Let me see here, Michael. This will answer your question. Exactly what's going on? What's at stake for everybody? All right. So let me read this. So this is talking about the trade, where the Europeans started to take over, all right? And, it was India. Remember, what was Catholic Spain trying to do? They were trying to get on the other side of Islam so they can get to India. And why was India so rich? And it's not just what they had, but they also had maritime trade with Indonesia, all those spices, all that exotic stuff coming from Indonesia, Philippines, and that whole area. And the Chinese had trade with them too. So that's where all the wealth was coming from, that massive population and all that stuff. Well, when the Spaniards went around the Cape of Good Hope, or the Portuguese, I apologize, the Portuguese went around the Cape of Good Hope in Africa, it completely bypassed the Islamic world. And so that was the first major transition, is it went from Islam to Christianity. Christianity gained 400% more power because of that. Just because of wealth, all right? And then so the Catholics had it. Then the the Portuguese obviously were going east around the Cape of Good Hope. Spaniards thought, hey, you know what? We'll go west and conquer that way. And that's where Christopher Columbus and all those guys come in. Super giant, brave human beings, all right? But then the Dutch and the English come along and they take all that away. So that's how it's been, in chronological order, that's how it's being played out. So bear with me, I'm going to read this. The transformative impact of the spice trade in Europe during the late Middle Ages and the Renaissance period cannot be overstated. It catalyzed a profound shift in the social, economic, and political landscape of the continent, ushering in an era marked by the rise of venture capitalism. Mark that word, it's venture capitalism that was perfected No, right. I talk about how that, you know, you and I get to participate. That's venture capitalism. It's not just capital, you know, it's venture capitalism. And they're burgeoning a mercantile class. This period was characterized by a significant shift from the feudal economies. So what did France and Spain and the Portuguese represent, the Austrians, you know what I mean? And they controlled it. Italy was the feudal system. Very, you know, so very specific. They controlled the feudal system. It was a collective system. And you had monarchies or monarchies, emperors, and popes. So I even wrote a report named Monarchies, Emperors, and Popes, and talking about the economic difference on what happened, what came with the Enlightenment age. All right. But there's something else. So that's what's at stake. The period was characterized by a significant shift from the feudal economies to a more market-oriented and capitalist economic structure. The flourishing spice trade not only enriched European merchants and monarchies, but also stimulated an unprecedented interest in global exploration and trade. This era saw the establishment of powerful trading companies and the expansion of maritime trade routes, which challenged and eventually broke the Islamic monopoly over the lucrative Silk Road and Indian Ocean trade networks. The decline of Islamic dominance in these regions was a critical turning point, redirecting wealth and power towards European nations. Simultaneously, Europe experienced a profound intellectual and cultural awakening. The rise of academies, of science, and the spread of humanist thoughts, which is the Enlightenment age, the spread of the humanist thoughts reflected an increasingly interconnected world. This intellectual fervor devoted the burgeoning Protestant Reformation, which championed individualism and questioned the longstanding authority of the Catholic Church. I know that offends people, but that's what happened. Like, you're not going to go to an economic class that doesn't state that. All right, so it's not an attack. It's an observation. The interplay between these movements laid the groundwork for a modern concept of individual rights and the separation of church and state. The Protestant ethos, with its emphasis on individual responsibility and economic self-determination, found a natural ally in the emerging capitalist ethos. The synergy between the Protestant values and the capitalist principles played a pivotal role in the development of modern economic theories and practice. It also indirectly contributed to the weakening of the Catholic Church, the political and economic influence. As Protestant nations and their merchants gained power, by the 18th century, the landscape of power had dramatically shifted. The once mighty Islamic empires, which had controlled key trade routes for centuries, were now eclipsed by the European powers. The rise of Napoleon, the French Republic, in the late 1700s, further challenged the traditional European power structure. Remember, Napoleon, you know, got rid of the Pope's powers. Now, he grew up Catholic, and later on, before his death, he went back to the Catholic Church. But that's, you know, during his rebellious years, as they call it, you know, he was part of the Enlightenment age, what he thought he was. You know, that's what he was. A lot of people accuse him of doing. So in the place of the old feudal and religious orders, a new world order was emerging, dominated by powerful European nations and their commercial enterprises. Portugal, Spain, Dutch, and English corporations and banks operating beyond the confines of medieval authority. So I'm going to stop right here. There's one little part here I have to read, one more. But I said Portuguese, Spanish, Dutch, and English, specifically corporations, because here's the transition, you guys. This is very important to understand. They went from empires to monarchies to popes to the state, then to corporations. That's the big threat in the world right now, is corporations. In other words, if you look at from a historical point of view, all right, you go look at the Dutch Far East India Company. And with all the research that I've done, in today's value, they're worth about $7 trillion. Today, they're still today the record-breaking company that was the most wealthiest company on the planet. In other words, they were wealthier than all those countries. So you see where there's a threat to people who believe in state. The state should rule. Well, how do you do that when a corporation is making more money than you and it's yielding more political influence than you? All right, so that's what's at stake. So the multipolar world, they don't believe in corporations. These corporations take away the power from them. And what is that power? Wealth. Remember that formula I keep telling you guys about? Resources plus manpower equals production. Production equals wealth, and wealth equals power. That is the elite. That is their formula. They live by it. That's what the average guy doesn't know or contemplate every time they talk about politics or economics or geopolitics in general. You have to, that should be on a bumper sticker on your car. It should be on your mirror. Tattoo it on your forehead backwards so when you look in the mirror, you can see it every morning, whatever. But that's what it is. That's the motivator. That's what's going on. But if you start to put in chronological order, so what was a threat to empires? Monarchies. What was a threat to monarchies? States. Separation of church and state. And what's a threat to a state? Corporations. So the multipolar world is completely trying to get rid of that in chronological order. The people that want to rule by their religion and live by their religious laws. And by the way, I don't have any type of, if Islam wants to be Islam, that's fantastic. They want to live by the laws, that's fantastic. But, they're trying to force everybody else to do it. Same thing with the Catholics. Same thing with the early Protestants. So everybody's guilty. That's the people don't realize everybody's guilty until you start getting these countries where it's in their constitution that everybody's allowed to participate. And everybody, nobody's perfect, but they're the least guilty. They're the least guilty. So that's what's at stake, is that you look at the conundrum that Iraq is in. Almost everybody's is Islamic. I know there's two sides to that coin because you have one side that's Sunni and one side that's Shia. But you have people that believe in that world, all right, but they understand that it's venture capitalism corporations that are the future for wealth. They're not going to be able to beat these corporations. And if you destroy the corporations, they're the ones producing the product. They lose power anyway. So it's a conundrum, right? They these corporations, the United States, they create all these products, and then the government and the military can benefit from it. Or vice versa. There's people in the military that get these unbelievable loans from the government, develop weapons and technology, and then it goes into the private sector. All right? They don't want to mess with that. But at the same time, we're talking the multipolar world. They don't want to mess with that, but at the same time they want to rule. And see, you can't have your cake and then eat it too. It's impossible. So either people are free and they're going to expand and the markets are going to get bigger and bigger, and that's what the United States is all about. We're about expanding our markets. And the multipolar world calls that the New World Order. They also call it think about this, right? We want to expand our markets into the Middle East. We want to be able to sell our products into the Middle East. Most of the Middle East is Islamic. I don't remember anybody telling you them you can't be Islamic, or it needs to be separation of church and state. So there's a hierarchy in our policy. Do we wish that would happen? Sure. Do we demand that happen? No, we don't. So United States doesn't need to expand its market based on a country that's just 100% a democracy, all right? But here's the problem. They do demand that, we give up our rights and we give up our freedom and we give up, so it's a one-sided deal. So the United States knows if you go out there and you show people that what we have, the average citizen, the access that we have, and then you look at the multipolar world, and this is before the multipolar world, guys. The third world countries, the second world countries, USSR, they're going to pick the United States every single time. There might be a few people out there that don't want it, and that's fine. But everybody's trying to get to the United States. Nobody's trying to get to Russia. All right? They're having a brain drain right now. They're, how are Chinese ending up on our southern border? I mean, how far you have to travel? Well, I don't know any Americans that are on the southern border of China trying to get in. Please let us. I don't know anybody. There's a whole Islamic group in China trying to get out. They're being held captive. It's completely opposite. But that's the threat to these guys. So that, to the multipolar world, to the collective. It doesn't matter if they're Catholic, socialist, communist, you know, whatever definition you want to put them under, is they don't have power because they've lost the power of production. They've lost the workers. They've lost the people who develop. They no longer have control of it. So what was that mechanism that separated those powers, those old feudal powers? What separated them? It had to do with venture capitalism. You can go get money anywhere now. You see how it works? So that's why Iraq has to sit on the fence and figure out how they're going to do this. You know, they might have to play both sides. They might not have, you know, but the multipolar world is not going to outspend us. That's one. Number two, they're not going to have as many customers as us. Number three, they're not going to have as much products as we do. So remember this, you guys, that, you know, they will expand using their own currencies. They're gonna use their own currencies more and more and more, and there's nothing wrong with that. But people keep forgetting that the United States, we're gaining more and more customers in different realms. So the dollar is going to be used more and more. So you, remember, as a measuring tool, the last audio I did, the measuring tool is how much is the multipolar world gaining by using their own currencies? All right. What people aren't looking at is how much of the markets are we expanding into? It's like they don't consider it. And you have to consider it to be honest with yourself. And you know what I mean? You have to measure both sides of the football. What's the victims look like? How are their players doing? What are their statistics? For some reason, people aren't doing that. And I mean across the board. I don't mean you people. I mean in the military, in the political realm. When somebody has an opinion, you ask them the very honest questions. Like, okay, the multipolar world is doing this. What is the West doing? And they won't tell you. They don't know. They never even contemplated it. So when I bring up the PG2 and the IPEF and we're bringing our, you know, they're like, where do you get that information at? It's like, dude, it's at the White House. They put articles out about it, all kinds of, you know, but nobody sees it that way because they're stuck in a rut. They're not looking for it is why they miss it. It's like, how is it possible that it's there and I didn't see it? Because you're not looking for it. So that's what I do is I introduce people to that information so they can look for it correctly and then be able to compare. And that's it. That's all it is. That's the key to the research. Look at both sides of the aisle, and there might be more than, you know, two sides, might be three sides, you know, but you have to look at them. You have to honestly recognize them, and you have to give each side the benefit of the doubt before you start getting into it. You have to be honest about it, and then you get into it. So that's the threat, is that you have the multipolar world, and it's about production, right? Production equals wealth, and wealth equals power. All right. Well, the corporations have taken that away from the states. So if they've taken it away from the states, they've definitely taken it away from the monarchies. And there is no emperors anymore. You know, you have the communists is the closest thing. It's just a different form of it. But that's why they go after corporations. We live in an age where there's corporations being accused of being communists. It's like, well, how's that possible? These guys are conducting international business. Then they start tying batshit crazy stuff to it that, you know, none of it makes any sense. Like, all right, so these guys don't make any money if people don't have the U.S. dollar. So here's the thing, you guys. All these corporations are pushing the U.S. dollar. Western corporations are pushing the U.S. dollar. And they want you to have the U.S. dollar in your pocket so they can make a profit. That's it. It's all about expanding their markets. They want it, you know, so you say that they want to, you know, they're these evil people and they want to get power. Okay, let's go over the formula again. Resources plus manpower equals wealth. Wealth equals power. It's wealth that equals power, ladies and gentlemen. So that's how it works. So where do they get their wealth from? From us. And who actually produces it from the property, the land? The labor force. Remember, resources and manpower is the key. Resources and manpower, that leads to wealth. And then wealth leads to power. So, you know, and that's the formula. So you have dictatorships that want to just use slave labor like they did in the USSR. Nobody had any money. Nobody had anything. They could talk all the, you know, whatever they want, but that's what happened. And then it collapsed. Why did it collapse? Because they went broke. They didn't produce anything. Everybody's like, I wonder what really happened. We found out that they didn't. You guys remember Herb Meyer? Yeah, he got a presidential award for pointing out, like, these guys are lying. These guys are broke. He went to the CIA, and he's like, how are you guys measuring that the USSR's their GDP is growing 4 or 5% a year? And the CIA is like, well, we get it from them. He's like, well, you might want to do that math again. And we found out they were going broke the whole time. And so we just upped their spending, which caused a reaction from the USSR to up their spending. They went broke. That simple. Star Wars and all that stuff. So we got really proactive. The United States was in defensive mode most of the Cold War. Ronald Reagan shows up, and then we go on the offense. They went broke. But we spooled up our production, ladies and gentlemen. So that's the thing, all right? So consider that. Consider the multipolar world. What can they produce? It's not that they don't have resources. They have fantastic resources. But what markets are they going to get them to? The markets, they don't have any money. All the markets, the Argentina, Brazil, all these guys are talking about, they're in massive inflation problems. We're not talking about 1% or 2% in their economy like the West. We're talking like 80%, 90%, 140%. Yeah, and nobody disagrees. They're all going through that, all right? And they're going to beat us out? It doesn't make any sense. So, you know, that's what Iraq's looking at. But there's multiple threats to that world, and it's not just the United States. It's the corporations. That's the main thing. That's why that book, The Sovereign Individual, is so important. Is because it explores all that. And this is like in the 80s, all right? Oh, no, it can't be that, because it talked about it was an update. I'm sorry, it was a revised version. But the latest one talks about the, you know, supposedly the Y2K. You guys remember that? And then how chips were going to, you know, all this stuff, all this gloom and doom never happened. But they, you know, it talks about how corporations are going to gain more and more power, and corporations are going to cause you and I, the individual, to be have more and more sovereignty. So think about this from that perspective. Who would you go with? Who would you give your allegiance to? Probably somebody who gave you wealth and sovereignty, or entity, or you know, a conglomerate of entities. It's not going to be people that take away your sovereignty. It's not going to, you see what I mean? That's why corporations are such a threat. And so the number one case that you can look is the Dutch, where, you know, venture capitalism, people could pool money and it just whatever. Someone had an idea, they threw money into it, it failed. Who cares? Let's go invest in this guy over here. That failed too. Who cares? Let's go invest over here. This one won. We're all rich. That's how it worked. You know, their economy proved it. Then the British did their economy. And then the United States did their economy. All right. So, you know, so more than likely it's going to be with Iraq. It's, you know, they're going to have to do some type of hybrid agreement, economic agreement with both sides. They're going to have to. You know, I don't see any threats coming from Iran yet to where you have to choose our side. You know, that would be a bad move for Iran. They would disappear. That'd be a very, 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 very bad move. But, you know, you have to consider that, though. But remember, going back, all right, going back, because I'm getting a ton of email from you guys still, that Iraq is not trying to get rid of the U.S. dollar out of their system. They're trying to get it rid out of the public so they get the supply times, the velocity of their dinar will go up. They don't have to compete with the dollar inside, domestically, inside of Iraq. So they have a massive dollar reserve, and that's it. That's it. So, you know, the problem is I get emails from people saying, well, you know, the multipolar world, they're using more and more people are getting rid of the U.S. dollar. That's not true. They use the U.S. dollar when they have to, but they're trying to advance their own currencies. Remember, there is no BRICS currency. Brazil has their currency. China has their currency. Russia has their currency. You know, and they're all trying to advance their own currencies. Guys, there's nothing wrong with that. So they're not going to beat the U.S. dollar. they all still use the U.S. dollar. Russia still has the U.S. dollar in the reserve. At the beginning of the Ukraine war, the second invasion, not the 2014 invasion, the second invasion, we seized or froze $500 million of Russia's U.S. dollars, their wealth, because we could do that. And it was in U.S. dollars. All right, that was the U.S. dollars that we can control. But they still have U.S. dollars. There's still U.S. dollars that backs up the Russian ruble right now. So it's not what people, you know, it's not what it seems. It's not what people think it is. All right, so let me read this last part of my book. So in place of the feudal and religious orders, a new world order was emerging, dominated by powerful European nations and their commercial enterprises. The Portuguese, Spanish, Dutch, and English corporations and banks operating beyond the confines of medieval authority structure amassed wealth and influence on an unprecedented scale. These entities, more powerful than many of the states themselves, heralded the rise of a new class of power brokers, the oligarchs and plutocrats. Their influence reshaped global politics and economics, setting in motion dynamics that continue to influence world affairs into the modern era. So think about this. Think about the negative articles you read about the oligarchs, those bastards. Who's putting that out there? They can't be the capitalists, because the more wealth we get and the more corporation we – you guys, we don't need a political system if you know, it's not like it's written in stone somewhere. We don't need a certain type of system. We need trade. That's what we need. So if you know that it's the venture capitalists, the central banks, which backed up all the private banks, and it destroyed feudalism. It destroyed the church's authority. It destroyed all of them, the monarchies, the emperors. So let's think about this. I wonder where all the negative shit is coming from against the venture capitalists and the capitalists and the central bank. I wonder where all that's coming from. You see what I mean? It's so easy to trace. It's so easy to trace. All these guys, I could tell you what books they read. Most of them admit it, by the way. I could tell you what books they read, and I could tell you where the guys that got that information, that wrote those books, where they got the information, where they were influenced. Because there's a DNA to it. A bunch of books came out, and they all refer to another book somehow, or the conspiracy starts in a book somewhere, and then you can trace it back to that. It's very easy. Well, it's easy now that I've actually done it, but it took me years to do it. But it's not hard. Once you start thinking about it, it's not hard. You start figuring, they had an enemy, and who was that enemy? The people that took away their power. Forget about any other titles. Forget about, any churches or anything like that, because it was venture capital and that whole setup that destroyed state authority and religious authority. A lot of people could say, well, the Protestants, they had a better argument. It was not that stopped Catholic authority or monarchies. You could separate those two, because not all monarchies were Catholic, were they? It was, you guys, it was the way that people can raise money, the way that people can get money. And the same accusations of devil worshiping and all that stuff. What do you think the religious groups are going to say? Of course they're going to say, these guys worship the devil. They've been doing it for 1,000 years. My family members, they burnt at the stake because they had Bibles. All right, so, but in the end, what is it? Is it really religion, or is it because it's bad for business? Yeah, I think it's bad for business. So let's go over the power structure again. Wealth equals power. And that's where they're offended. It took away their wealth, and it took away their power. And that's what's going on. More and more of these corporations are becoming giants. Okay, so let's spool it up a little bit, because Bob has been talking about AI a lot. Fascinated by it, right? Fantastic. And it is great. It is. But it's leaving all these old school feudalists that have a little bit of lingering hope that somehow they're going to come back and they're going to get rid of modernity. You know, they call it modernity. You know what I mean? The modern world. Because they don't produce nothing. They don't, you know, that's not their, you know, that's not their thing. They don't produce products. They don't. So it'll never work. Now we're in the AI age where, you know, you look at Elon Musk and all these guys are fighting for all these markets and the technology that will actually control these markets. And it's beyond anybody's imagination. You know what I mean? So they're speculating in about 2.5 to 3 years, they will have AI that'll be just as smart as the smartest guy out there right now. Maybe not in every subject, but, you know, able to create. And all of them are saying the exact same thing. Be able to create things out of thin air. In other words, new principles in physics and, you know, all that stuff. We're about 3 years away from it. All right. So it's a major threat to these guys that believe in the feudal system and that want to rule. And they want to control the wealth. Because they're losing more and more. So let's throw this a little bit of math out there. All right. I don't know if it was the last audio, the audio before that, I talked about how that, you know, you have this information war. The United States will win because we control 70%. Actually, it's 80%. 85%. Exactly 85% of all the communication wires for the internet. We control 85% of it. The rest of the world with China and Europe own 15%. All right. We control the rest of it. Well, that's an easy win. All right. But what about satellites? All these new satellites that are going up. There's one company out there that controls 80% of that. It's a company. You guys want to guess what company that is? That's throwing satellites up there and a percentage of the chunk of the information market they own. Yeah, it's Elon Musk Starlink. He owns 80% of it. So you see what I mean? Yeah, no shit, they're afraid of this stuff. They can't stand it. He's evil. He's a son of a bitch. Then you look at the electric vehicles, and he produces and sells more electric vehicles than all the companies on the earth combined that are producing electric cars. And I think hybrids, too, even though Elon Musk doesn't produce hybrids, but I think they even beat that category combined. Yeah, major, major. They like the guy personally, I guarantee you. You know what I mean? They like his money. But that's the threat. That's what the big threat is from Elon Musk. So what do you think they're going to say? They're going to fight it tooth and nail, ladies and gentlemen. So anyways, the you know, it's going to be interesting. It is. It's going to be very, very interesting because – you know, we call it AI, right? But the reality is the fourth industrial revolution. It's information. It's artificial intelligence. It's communication devices. It's all of it. It's that ecosystem that's going to change everything. But the reason I read a part of that, my book to you guys that's coming out, where it talks about how it went from empires to monarchies to states, and then to corporations, is because that's going to advance. You're going to see corporations have more and more and more power, more influence, because they're the ones producing all this stuff. And so you have to consider what it is that they're offering, what's out there. And you guys, it's so much. It's not just, you know, the ability to help you put together a nice little email and stuff like that. It's programming. It's being able to, I don't know if you guys know this, but the health products that they have out there, there's a health product out there, service, all right? It scans your body. It scans your body for everything. It doesn't cure it or anything like that, but it scans it. And then you go take a test again. And it, by the way, if there's anything in your body, it'll scan and detect it. But let's say it's perfect. Let's say your body's perfect. Then the next time you scan, it'll compare from the last scan, and it starts measuring things. And it'll get rid of cancer. It'll find whatever's going to come up before it happens. We're talking, you got a whole different level here. That's the type of stuff that's going on. That's the thing. I've been researching that for about a year. Unbelievable. There's even different versions of it. There's a version out of Texas. I think it's like $2,500, and they kind of do the same thing on a smaller scale, but that's what they're doing, is they create a database of every chemical that's in your body and how it operates on all that stuff that's unique to you, and they compare it. And they're able to block all these different health elements that come up that we before were invisible. We never knew about it. So it's kind of neat, isn't it? It's kind of remarkable. Think about this. You know, back in the dark ages, you know, people could drink water and die, but they didn't know anything about germs or bacteria or viruses and all that stuff back in those days. If they would have just boiled that water, nobody would have ever died of any of that stuff from drinking water. All right. So what was it? They couldn't see. They didn't know. They didn't know that, you know, any of that stuff existed. So someone threw a microscope. Well, it's the same thing that's going on now. AI is able to see everything that we wasn't seeing before. So here we go. We're able to recognize that much more. And it's all AI driven. So very interesting. And the reason I'm bringing that up is because the, you know, you guys, a rock is going to be fine. All right. That's one. And there could be civil wars. There could stuff that could happen with Iran and all that stuff. But in the end, they're going to be fine. Financially, it's going to be tough. You imagine going through a war, and I believe this with all my heart, the sovereign individual. There's a whole chapter that talks about how imagine going through a war. You know how devastating wars are? You lose your finances, and you know what I mean? Your entire industry, the whole chain of the value chain of it disappears. Well, in the book, The Sovereign Individual, it talks about because of corporations and how everybody's connected from a global perspective, you could go through a war, and guess what? Because of blockchain technology, your wealth won't be touched. And I believe it 100%. You know, are we there this second? No, but that's what we're talking about. The ecosystem of all this stuff is just remarkable. You guys, you know, you should consider what these guys are talking about, all of them. They're talking about an age of abundance. There'll be nothing that you can't have access to. So whether the dinar revalues, and I think it will, and if it does revalue, people are asking me, and this is the last question because people keep asking me, Tony, I'm not going to go invest what you tell me. I'm not going to, you know, because you guys know I'm shy. I can't tell people what to invest in, like a certain product or something like that. I can have a guest on and they can introduce it, but you know, something like that. But the problem is, it is AI. So what, if it revalues, what can I invest in? Real estate and AI, ladies and gentlemen, you know what I mean? They're all, you know, it will be AI. So what can I invest in? Well, you know, there's all kinds of companies you can invest in. You have to go look, a lot of them are private. Because they really don't need investors. It's private. And, you know, they see the potential, and guys like Elon Musk and Bill Gates and all, they just throw, you know, they'll throw $1 billion in it like nothing. In fact, they have. So that's what I would recommend. So even if the dinar doesn't revalue, it's like, look, that's a shoebox investment. I'm done. I just watch to see if there's any potential when it's going to revalue. That's it. And that's I hope that's where you guys are at. But you need to be watching this AI world because it is a game changer. Since it came out, and it's, you guys, it's at its bare minimum mode right now. And it has completely changed me on how I communicate with people that I do research for and all that stuff. It's so beyond what I was able to do before. It's unbelievable. And like I said, I've encouraged a lot of my friends, you know, it's like, just go out and learn the basics of programming. You don't even have to be a programmer. And how would you do that? Just go out and, you know, like I encourage my friends to learn Python. All right. And not for any particular reason other than it's one of the easiest ones to learn. And they're like, well, how do we do this? Like, go out and create a card game, you know, a poker game. Program a poker game. Even though you're not going to use it or whatever, you know how it's done. Create an accounting software. The simplest one you can. Create a calculator. And it's the only way you're going to learn how to program properly is to have an assembly line of projects. Create a website that has a way to process money. And then so you're stacking all that knowledge up, create a calendar, create a weather site, create, that's how I learned how to program, you guys. I didn't go to school. Just one project after another. And I'll be honest with you, with the first 6 months, I had no clue what I was doing. I you know, they were success. I was building stuff, but it didn't formulate in my mind. And then one day it became a picture. It's like, this is how everything connects. This is how these files, because there was a pattern. Every software every project that I got into, they were starting, I seen the patterns on how they were stacked. That's how you do it. But guess what? That is cool. You don't need that anymore because AI will program it for you. So, secondly, shit. Bob and I have been talking about how to develop apps. And it's an Android app, right? So you want to develop a app for a phone. Well, you go download a piece of software where you develop apps for Android. And I'm going through it and writing this stuff down for me, my own notes, and how to do this and all that stuff. Then I went to ChatGPT. I paid the $20 for the high-end ChatGPT. It was like, hey, how do you – and it boom, within 3 seconds. It not only did it surpass everything that I wrote down, but, you know, it showed me exactly how to do it. It's like, well, shit. Then I asked it. It's like, okay, what I want to do is I want to put an app out there that gets information. And it showed me that you need to create a website that actually has the source of the information you want, where your app's going to get that. And this is how you connect it. And this is how you set it to update. It's like, Jesus, out of never, you guys, I could pay $20,000 to go get that type of information, that type of engineering. And it just spits it out under 3 seconds. It's like, huh, all right. So it is remarkable. It is remarkable. And so you got to, you know, Bob said that there'll be two companies out there. What he meant to say, there's two type of companies that are going to be out there. Ones that are AI and ones that are not, and the ones that are not are going to disappear. And I believe that. You guys, it is superior information. It will be superior knowledge. There will be no mistakes. There's no mistakes. And so it's just, you know, I know there's information that it puts out there and it's not, it's wrong, but I'm talking about calculations and stuff like that. So the projects that my friends who are way smarter than me, and these guys know how to, these guys are engineers. They're like, dude, there's no mistakes. It's unbelievable. If it makes a mistake, it's because you asked it the wrong question. You gave it the wrong, you know what I mean? That's where it's limited, is how you ask it. So what am I telling you guys? I'm telling you, there is no limits for you. You can write that book. You can make an app. You can program. You can create products. You can support people that create products. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It'll help you. If you want to be a day trader, go look on YouTube and watch these guys talk about how ChatGPT or a AI system helps them day trade, how it helps them figure out how to day trade and create a plan for day trading. It'll blow your mind. It'll blow your mind. So you guys, you know, regardless of what you believe, and, you know, I go back and forth with people that believe in conspiracies and all that stuff. That's all fun. It's cool. It's fun. I don't hate anybody. And I get rough. You know what I mean? I do. I know what I'm doing. I get rough and I poke. All right. But in the end, you guys, you don't need to fear about the future one way or the other. You just don't. AI is you will be living in the age of abundance. The most curious time in the history of all mankind, and you're in it, and you should consider it the biggest blessing. You are the chosen one. Nobody's going to get everything's going to be unleashed, and we're the ones who are going to be able to use it. If it goes bad, let's say if it goes bad, you and I won't be alive. That'll be on down the road. Screw those guys, right? It's us. No, but it's what an opportunity. I'm not kidding. Like, I can't sleep thinking about this stuff. I go through these websites and watch these guys use these different apps for AI and all that stuff, and it's just absolutely unbelievable. And I can't sleep because I can't turn my mind off on, you know, what can I use that for? What can I do with this? I'll give you guys a little bit of a taste. I've been thinking about doing documentaries on some of the stuff that I talk about, on geopolitics and stuff like that. But how do I do that? How do I represent it? Do I got to go film someplace? Well, with AI, and it's not about it picking pictures or anything like that. I'm talking about, it'll help you design a map and put animation on it, and timelines on it, and you guys, it's just endless. So later on down the road, actually Bob will be showing you some of that stuff. He'll be showing you some of that stuff, but I will too, because I want to show you how AI changed my research, and I want to be able to, we'll have a couple case studies for you guys. So that was one of the main reasons. I wanted to answer questions, but one of the main things I wanted to tell you guys is that we'll go through a couple things, and we'll just get in front of AI. So you guys are looking at my screen, right? And we'll start figuring out some stuff, how it can help you do research, how it can answer questions, how it can quantify information for you or help you quantify it. And it is so exciting. It's so cool. It's so fun. But anyways, I just wanted to tell you guys, next audio I put out, I'm going to go after a couple people. All right. And it's not anybody that believes in conspiracies or anything like that. So there's a couple guys. I'm always going through emails with people, by the way, 24/7, that people that are arguing. So it's kind of weird. People think they're the only ones, you guys, it's a hobby. It for some reason, I get a kick out of it. It cracks Bob up. He's like, "What's wrong with you?" I know how to piss people off. But the thing about it is that it's not about that. I'm not going after anybody. But there's people in the dinar world that keep coming after me and stuff like that. And I told you guys, there's a reason that I had events where I can actually shake your hand, say, "Hey," even if you disagreed with me. So here I am. This is what I am. Even if I make mistakes or whatever, but here I am. A lot of these people, they don't want you to know who they are. They don't want to take accountability for anything they've said or anything like that. So a couple of them keep coming after me. So I'm going to change that a little bit. All right. So that'll be fun. That'll be entertaining. But you guys, on the level, all right, I'm not worried about conspiracy theories. I'm not. I get paid to do that stuff. And the people that pay me, they trust everything I put down. Everything can be proven in a court of law. That's not the problem. I'm really worried because people are scared. They really are scared. They really think that, this whole thing is going sideways. So consider this. Forget about what you believe in and what you don't believe. Just look in the past on people believing that World War III was going to happen in the 60s and the 70s. In the 80s and the 90s and the early 2000s. How did they invest? If you can't get rid of the fear, at least invest like the markets are going to grow and it's not all coming to an end. At least invest if you can't emotionally detach yourself from that stuff. At a minimum, I beg you, because you will benefit from it and your families will benefit from it. There's no way. You guys, a long time ago, I've had people ask me, this group, it's like, well, because I told people that when I learned the art of geopolitics and all that stuff, they told us, don't go out talking about this stuff. It's like, well, why? Is it a secret? They're like, no, it's not a secret. It's all public information. Because people won't be able to grab, they don't have that background. The truth is not for everybody. And I rejected that. Well, they were right and I was wrong. So, it's not part of the public curriculum and it's foreign. Truth is foreign. You know what I mean? Once people figure it out, like there's people in this crowd that listen to this stuff and you're like, oh my God, they get it like quick. They're smart. They get it. But that's what I do. I throw this stuff out and I'm not worried about people that disagree. I'm worried about people that agree. I throw that net out and I pull them in. And almost every one of you guys has had a religious experience learning the truth on how these things work, especially how the markets work and the motivation behind different political theories and stuff like that. It's all market driven. It's all economic driven, all of it. So it's kind of remarkable, you guys, and it's been an honor and it's been a pleasure. Even before I met you guys, that is it. That's the ultimate thing. I've retired from it a couple times. It seemed like I was doing the same thing. I needed to move on. But then I start getting back into the game a little bit and I can't help it. I'm addicted to it. So I'll never go away when it comes to that stuff. So real quick, and then I'll let you guys go. All right? You need to, the minute this audio is over, you need to just start jumping into every YouTube video you can on AI, on the people who created it and the top products that are out there. Do not worry about people that did not create it and their opinions. Go listen to the audios to the people that created it, the people that have the authority, and they will tell you the future. They'll tell you it's going to be the age of abundance. And it's remarkable. And they're all telling, because they know what it can do. They're like, you won't believe it. It's beyond anything when we start off. It's beyond that. So just consider that. All right? Just consider that and go watch that stuff. But in the meantime, you guys, any more questions on any of this stuff? The next couple of audios that come out will be great. Bob will be back and talk a little bit more about what they're offering, all that stuff. Just so you guys know, I'm not financially attached to any of that stuff. I'm not promoting it. I'm not even talking about today's stuff to promote what those guys are doing. I'm telling you, you need to go out and invest in AI. You need to figure it out. You're going to be left in the dust. You will suffer. I don't think it's going to be gloom and doom for you. I think no matter what you're going to, but you want to be at the apex of this stuff. You want to be at the front of it. You want to be at the front of it. Remember the 80s and the 90s when the computer, the internet, it all came out and, there was more wealth created in the history of mankind than ever. And there's a whole group of people out there waiting for the end to happen, all the way up to the Y2K. You guys remember that? I know you remember that. I know you do. Don't do that again. Don't be fooled by evil. Don't listen to their lies. Just invest. Just invest. And if you don't have money to invest, then try to go out and create your own product based on it. What product can you sell that somebody else, You invest that way. Invest labor-wise. And you guys, it'll I promise you, it'll work out for you. You'll find it, but you got to search for it. But look, you guys, I got to go. Thank you for the questions. Thank you for the support. I've been getting a lot of email from you guys asking me, hey, why do these guys attack? Why do they, you guys, I guarantee when they send these emails, the adrenaline is going through them and they're shaking. I guarantee it. They're offended. It's just how it works. People want to be right. There's nothing wrong with that, right? There's nothing wrong with that. But you have to be right, though. You can't be wrong. And so, but that's all it is. That's why these, people do that. They bought something, they emotionally vested in it, and then you start poking holes in it, and it's like, holy shit. They're gonna do what we call the monkey dance. They're gonna create a psychological perimeter around it, and they will defend it to the death. And it doesn't matter how wrong they are. That's how humans work. So I keep saying I'm gonna stop here, guys. One more thing, all right? I want you to consider this. The human mind works, and all of us are like this, every one of us. The path of least resistance, whether it comes to philosophy, theology, work, it's the path of least resistance. Well, AI, so how do you, all militaries and elites have known this. They know, they sit there and they watch, and they've known for thousands of years that, it's the path of least resistance. All right, so what are the elite, they work outside of those boundaries. They don't have any type of resistance. They work more. They don't try to work less, they try to work more. They try to work out more. They try to educate themselves more. Now think about that. Think what AI does. AI defeats the path of least resistance. And that's my definition. That comes from me. Nobody else has said that, but that's me. That's what's so unbelievable about even my dad, when he taught people how to fight in the military, it's the pain is a learning accelerator. It helps you learn quicker. Don't be offended. And they're like, well, what's that mean? Well, they found out. But they so imagine what AI can do. Imagine how it can accelerate. Imagine how many books that it can help you read. just by doing a book review. I have a app where you throw a PDF in, and your book, you throw it in there, and you can start asking questions, and it's a complete chat bot based on that book that you just put in there. So not only can you read it, but you don't have to read it if you want. It's like, what's the most important chapters? What's the most, you know, it's unbelievable. But it kind of helps us get out of the path of least resistance. And that, I mean, you guys can understand that. I know you guys completely agree with that, because we all do it. We're all a little bit lazy somehow, some way. So how do you stop that? AI, ladies and gentlemen. But anyways, again, you guys, thank you for the emails, the participation, the support, and all that stuff. And until the next audio, everybody, God bless. Thanks all.